That answer was China, and it's no longer. China's population is actually getting smaller. India's population is blowing up. So the United States population right now is about 330 million. Multiply that by four. India has like 1.4 billion people right now. Depending on which website you go to, there are 50, 55, 60 cities in India that have populations of more than a million people. And off of those big cities, out in the rural areas, often rural areas in India have tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people in their cities. And in a lot of those cities are slums. Some of you have traveled the world. Some of you have traveled the world and gone to the nice touristy places. We're not talking about that. Some of you have traveled the world and you've seen real slums. I've been to big cities before, and I've seen places where people struggle. Okay? Are you speaking my language? Okay. I've seen big, rich neighborhoods, and I've seen poor, poor, poor neighborhoods, but I don't think many of us who haven't been in a third world slum can comprehend the need and the vastness of it. Michael Frost, an author, Michael Frost tells a story about a missions organization, a gathering of churches going to a slum in a suburb of a big city in India, with tens of thousands of people in this slum, a place where people make their own houses out of cardboard and wood scraps, and they eke out just something to eat today. A missions organization, a bunch of Christians from the West, went to India to do good in Jesus' name. That's good, right? Okay, that's what we should do. And they went and they met with some of the folks in this slum and they said, here's what we can do. We've got resources, we've got manpower, we've got materials. We could do several different things. We could build you a medical clinic. We could build a medical clinic so the thousands and thousands and tens of thousands of people in this gently called area, or slum, would have access to medical care. We could build you a school where the kids could gather and they could begin to be educated so they some could start making their way out of just this oppressive poverty. We could build you a church. If you want a place where you can come and gather and you can worship and we can talk about Jesus, we could build you a church. So tell us what you need. We could build you a clinic. We could build you a school. We could build you a church. Just tell us what you need. And the leaders there in the slum, out in the middle of India, in this place of just overwhelming poverty, says, actually what we could really use, what we need most, is a mailbox. Now, when I first heard this story, I thought, that is the dumbest response I have ever heard to the what can we do for you. But hang in there. I'm going to tell you the rest of that story in a minute. Last week, I asked you on the way to church to count red cars. Last Sunday, how many of you counted cars on the way? Okay, a few. We caught a few of you. How many counted cars on the way into church this morning? A few more. Okay, a few different. Now, let me tell you why this is important. On any random Sunday, This is my candle, brought to you by the very nice people at Hobby Lobby. This is my candle. On any week where between the close of service today and the start of service next week, somebody lets me know, hey, Rich, I was able to talk to somebody about Jesus. I was able to pray with somebody. I was able to bring encouragement. I was able to serve my neighbor. I was able to go and do something for somebody. And then they call me and tell me, hey, Rich, here's what happened, or text me or whatever, and then say, hey, light the candle. We do that. And on any given week, I usually get one or two people that will do that. Last week, we talked about beginning to intentionally pray for people. And I asked you last week to actually write them down. Write down 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 people that you're going to be praying for. Did anybody do that? Well, you're just blessing my heart this morning. I can't wait to see what happens after I preach today. So I told you, write them down, write down names, and then I told you to hold me accountable and make sure I wrote mine down. And so about Wednesday, I thought, okay, they're in my brain, but I got to write them down because somebody's going to ask me on Sunday. And then Thursday, I thought, I've got to write them down because somebody's going to ask me. And then we had district assembly this week, and that kind of gobbled up my brain on Thursday and Friday. And then yesterday was our day with baby Henry, and we got to spend a bunch of time with Henry. So this morning, I thought, oh, I've got to write them down because somebody's going to ask me. And so far, nobody's asked me, but I did. And here's my little note card, and it's got a little box with an X in it. That's my house, because I'm an artist. And next door to me are our neighbors to our left, and next door to us on the right is an empty house. We've got neighbors coming this month or next month, and I've called them the Schmeckmans. And then across the street are some other neighbors, and across the street over here are people that I've not met. And then I told you last week that I've got a guy who just hangs around in his garage, and I've met him. And then I pass a guy out on Kirkwood, just a man sitting out in a rocking chair, and I didn't see him all week, and I pledged to myself that I was going to stop. And the reason I'm telling you this is this. I told you last week to start praying for people specifically so that when you had that ping, that God moment, that reminder, that poke on your shoulder to interact with them in a way that might bring the kingdom, that you're ready, that you've prayed for that opportunity, which is why I told you to look for red cars last week and a few more look for red cars this morning. And I tell you, on any given one week, I have one or two people that will say, Richard, light your candle. This week, 7 or 8 people told me, Rich, here's a story, light your candle. If we will pay attention and if we ask God to show us ways we can touch people for Jesus and bless them, he will. And if we don't, we probably won't. And we'll just zip on through life. I want you to open up your Bible. We finished up a series on Luke back at Easter, so turn to Luke. I can't get out of it. I'm sorry. Luke chapter 18, I want you to look at this story this morning. Over these last few weeks, we've been talking about what is the mission of Jesus. Jesus came to bring the kingdom, to establish the kingdom and further the and spread the kingdom. And he enlists you and me in doing that. And then a couple of weeks, we talked about the vision. What's the vision for this church? What do we want this church to look like? And I gave us two words. I want us to be growing together, growing in discipleship, knowing Jesus more. That can be done through knowing God's word more, knowing God's will for our lives more, but doing that together through relationship, growing together. So how do we do that? The why is to bring God's kingdom, to seek and save those who are lost. The vision is, what do we want that to look like here Over these next few weeks, we're looking at the how do we do that. Last week I said, write it down. Your real live neighbors, your neighbors who live next to you, the people who you work with, the people who you have lunch with, the people who you rub shoulders with. It could be other moms and dads on a ball team your kid plays ball with. It could be the people who you see every day, the same people at Waffle House, Starbucks, Publix, wherever you go. You recognize people, learn their names, tell them yours, and begin to build relationship. This morning, we're going to read a really strange story. I mean, strange in how we're telling it, not strange because it's in the Bible. But it's in all three of the Synoptic Gospels. It's in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and we're reading today out of Luke chapter 18. Starting in verse 35, as Jesus approached Jericho. Now, that's an important detail, by the way. Jesus has been in Galilee up to the north in Israel, as we would understand it. He's been in Galilee. That's kind of his home base. That's where home would be for him and most of his disciples. They've been in Galilee. Now, they're coming to Jerusalem for the Passover, where Jesus is going to teach, preach, come into the city. He's going to be opposed by the Jewish leaders. He's going to be crucified, and he's going to rise again. He's on his way to Jerusalem. He is a man on a mission. He's going somewhere. He's not just touring. As Jesus approached Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. Now, I think in Matthew or Mark, I think in Mark, we get his name. Anybody remember his name? Bartimaeus. Blind Bartimaeus. As Jesus approached Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging, and when he heard the crowd going by, he asked, "What's going on?" He asked what was happening. They told him, "Jesus of Nazareth is passing by." So he called out. Why does that matter? To a man who is blind and they see Jesus of Nazareth is passing by, who cares? Jesus had a reputation at this point. Jesus had been preaching and teaching in the area. Jesus' reputation was spreading and people knew him to be a great teacher and also a healer. So if you're a blind man who is a beggar and you know that a man who has healed blind eyes is walking by, what do you do? You do what blind Bartimaeus did. You freak out. He called out, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me!" Exclamation point. Those who led the way for Jesus rebuked him and told him to be quiet. Now, there's something there where I'm not going to talk about this morning, but there's something there that one of these days I'll get around to preaching that. But he shouted all the more, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped. I love that. Jesus is coming from someplace. He is going to someplace. He hasn't come to Jericho to vacation for the weekend. He's on his way through, and Jesus, with some place to go and things to do, he stops. Jesus stopped and ordered the man be brought to him. And when he came near, Jesus asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" Which I just have to ponder. Jesus, I don't know if you know, but this guy's name, what's your name? Bartimaeus. Okay. This guy's name is Bartimaeus, and he's a poor beggar, and he's blind. So when you come along and say, "What do you want me to do for you?" you're not paying attention. Jesus stopped and ordered the man be brought to him, and when he came near, Jesus asked, "What do you want me to do for you?" "Lord, I want to see." This week at District Assembly, our general superintendent was one of the two brand new general superintendents who were elected last year. We have six general superintendents in the Church of the Nazarene who kind of lead our church worldwide, and our District Assembly was this week, and our general's name is Scott Daniels. He's one of our new ones, and one of the things he said was, he mentioned this story, and he said, by the way, if Jesus ever asks you, what do you want me to do for you, this is always the right answer. Always. Jesus, I want to see. Whether your eyes work or not, always the right answer when Jesus says, what do you want me to do for you, is, Jesus, I want to see. And Jesus said to him, receive your sight. Your faith has healed you. And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus, praising God. Jesus is in a crowd. It's loud. Blind Bartimaeus is over by the side. How do we know? Because blind people stay to the side. Blind poor beggars stay to the side. They're down low. They're forgotten. You walk past blind Bartimaeus 10 times out of 10. And now Jesus is surrounded by a parade of people. They're literally walking through Jericho because they're going someplace. How did Jesus see? How did Jesus hear Bartimaeus? Here's my theory. Do you remember back before Uber? How did you get from point A to point B if you did not have a car or a bus or a subway token? How did you get places back before Uber and Lyft? You called a taxi cab, okay? So either you got on the phone, remember pay phones, you'd put in a quarter and you'd dial a number, okay? So either you would call a cab to come pick you up, or most of the time, and this I know this mostly from watching TV shows and movies, you go out of your hotel, very fancy, New York City, and you look out on the road and you go like this. Now you have an app, and you open up the app, and doink, and now you know that Joe is coming to pick you up and will be there in 4.5 minutes, and what kind of car he drives and all that kind of stuff. Back in the dark ages, you would go out of the door, and you'd go like this. I've often wondered, in New York City, millions of people, thousands of cabs. How do you see a cab? How did you see a cab? They were bright yellow. It's kind of easy. There's not a lot of other bright yellow vehicles out there. I mean, if you have one, no judgment or anything, but how did the cab driver see you standing on a street corner or at an entrance in a hotel doing this? He's looking for you. Jesus is walking through Jericho. He's got places to go. He's got things to do. He's on his way to Jerusalem for Passover. The end of his earthly ministry is coming to a close. These are important minutes, hours, days. And somewhere in the hullabaloo in the middle of Jericho, he hears Bartimaeus and stops. I think that's important. Jesus asked, according to one guy who read the four Gospels and counted them, Jesus asked over 300 questions. Now, a lot of those are in teaching. Okay, a lot of those were rhetorical questions in teaching as he was teaching. He asked, very Jewish, by the way, he was teaching through questions. But some of the questions were like this. What do you want me to do for you? Why would you ask a blind man, what do you want me to do for you? When the obvious answer is, I want to see, and that's actually what ends up happening. He says, I want to see. Can I tell you the end of the Indian slum story? So these do-gooders from the West with a little bit of money and a little bit of resources and some guys and women who know how to nail things and build things, they say, we've got these resources, we've got this stuff, we can help you, we can do ABC, we can build a church, we can build a school, we can build a clinic, what can we do for you? And they said, what we really need most is a mailbox. To which the Westerners would say, I'm not sure you understood the question. We could build you, and at this point, you know, very patronizing, we'd probably start to act it out. A school building, a medical clinic, you know, a church, you know. And they say, no, we understand. What we really could use is a mailbox. Because in that area, in that society, in that culture, in that country, if you don't have a mailbox, you don't have a zip code. If you don't have a zip code, you're not a city. And if you're not a city, you're not on the map. And if you're not on the map, you have no access to the resources that the government could do for you. So a bunch of do-gooder Westerners could come in and build you a little schoolhouse. You know what good that would do? It would do good. But they said, what we really need most is a mailbox. Now, it's not a trip to Lowe's, get a mailbox and come back and plant it down in the ground. This was going through all the red tape with the government, which took 2 years to go to the local government and then the provincial government and then the national government and jump through all the hoops and fill out all the forms and go through all the red tape of getting this slum in the middle of this city a mailbox. It took them 2 years, but once they did, the place had a zip code, and the zip code had a name, and the name was on a map, and the people of that village, the people of that slum could start to receive things that they never had before. They never would have known that had they not listened. Last week, I asked you to start praying for specific people, and that is a practice. And it's actually a pretty simple practice. We can all do that. Start with one. I'd love for you to have 6, 8, 10 people, not 45 people, but a handful of people that you're praying for regularly. God, give me an opportunity to bless this person. As I have an opportunity, as I'm able to interact with them, you've blessed me, make me a blessing. Today, I want to challenge you to be a better listener. Jesus was a friend of sinners and regular folks and saints. Some people have said there are only two classes of people in the world today, sinners and Jesus. So good news, you have a friend. Here, Jesus interacts with this blind man, and he gives this blind man the dignity of the question. He stops, he eyeballs him. This isn't a drive-by healing. You know, Jesus, as he's speed walking by, everybody's calling out his name. He just sends the lightning bolts over Bartimaeus' way. Pew, pew, you can see. And he just keeps on going. He stops. He has the man brought to him. He looks at him and says, Bartimaeus, what can I do for you? What do you want me to do for you? The missions folks go to a slum in India and say, what can we do for you? And they get an answer that they didn't expect. Proverbs 18 says it like this: to answer before listening, that is folly and shame. There's wisdom in listening. Somebody said, I can't track down who said this first, the opposite of listening isn't speaking, it's waiting to speak. If you ever do that, you're having a conversation with somebody, this is way easier to hear in other people. You're having a conversation and somebody talks about being in a car accident, and what are you doing? you're already formulating your story about when you were in a car accident. Okay? Our pastor at the Park Lane Nazarene Church over off of Fort Campbell, his name is Nick Lennon. He's been there about a year and a half. And Nick's father died suddenly a week ago. And the family traveled to Florida, and they've had this, but it was very sudden, out of nowhere. And I so want to spend time with my friend Nick. But I'm having to stop myself saying, Nick, I got that phone call. Danny and I were just having a random, great September Sunday. And at 10 o'clock that night, I got that phone call. Out of nowhere, my dad was gone. And part of the reason I want to be with Nick is to help my friend. Part of the reason is to say, Nick, I've been there. But sometimes we need to shut up. And we just need to listen. To allow the other person to tell part of their story. By the way, that's being a good friend. Sometimes we think the way to build the kingdom, spread the kingdom, is by having all of our stuff memorized. So when we corner somebody in the lunchroom or on along the fence in the backyard, or God forbid you've got them captive in your car, we can spiel all over them and we can give them our sales pitch about church and about Jesus. I think Jesus gives us pretty good examples in the scriptures, and one of those examples is we should be quick to listen. Stephen Covey wrote a very, 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 very famous book, Seven Habits of Highly Effective People. Some of you all have read that, and one of those is seek first to understand, then to be understood. Dallas Willard, a great author, Christian author, said the first act of love is always the giving of attention. The very first thing Jesus did for Bartimaeus was have him brought to me, and he stops and he looks at him. He gives Bartimaeus his attention and says, "What can I do for you?" David Augsburg said it like this: being heard is so close to being loved that for the average person, they are almost indistinguishable. Every now and then, out of nowhere, Dana will say, "You're not even listening to me," which I think is a ridiculous way to start a conversation. Okay, I know that's not my joke. It's been said 1,000 times before. But she's right. I'm not listening. I'm paying attention to something else, or I'm thinking about something else, or I'm on my phone, or I'm scrolling my phone, and I'm looking at something else. I'm paying attention to something else. She's talking. She is the most important thing in my life right in front of me, and I'm not giving her my attention. Jesus gives us his attention. To be a friend, it's not so much about what we can say often. The cheat code, the shortcut to friendship is just being a listener. One of my New Year's resolutions this year was to be a better listener, because I'm this guy. I'm the guy who, as you're talking, I'm thinking of my story. Now, I think what I'm doing is coming alongside you and saying, "Oh, yes, me too, me too." But I'm not listening to you. I'm thinking of my story to tell you. How do we do this? Last week, I told you, start 6, 8, 10 people. Write them down. Have a list. Who are you praying for? God, you've been a blessing to me. How can I be a blessing to somebody else? Today, the practice, the strategy that I want us to focus on in bringing about the vision that we have for the church, a place that is growing together. It sounds overwhelmingly simple, but I want you to put into practice being a more intentional listener, because that builds friendship, that builds relationship faster than almost anything. 4 H words. Ready for this? History, heart, habits, hurts. These are ways you can be a better listener. History, tell me your story. Where are you from? Where'd you go to school? What'd you study? What do you do? Tell me your story, your history. Heart, what's your favorite? What do you like? Who do you cheer for? Okay. Habits, what are you into? What do you like to do? If you had $1,000, what would you spend it on? If you had a week and you could do anything, what would you do? Heart, hurts. How are you doing with? Somebody in the last few years said one of the most valuable things you can say to somebody who is hurting, and I've done this, I've put this into practice, is tell me about your loved one. So when I spend time with Nick, I'm not going to tell Nick my story. Maybe someday I'll tell Nick my story, but I'm going to say, Nick, I didn't know your dad. Tell me about your dad. History, heart, habits, hurts. We can all be better listeners, but it's not going to happen on accident. And I believe that put into practice, has anybody read The Compound Effect by Darren Hardy? One of my favorite books is this book called The Compound Effect. It's not a churchy book. It's not a Christian book. It's kind of a leadership book and a personal development book. And the whole idea is small, seemingly insignificant choices and habits done consistently, not for a day or a week or a month, over time will bring a great harvest. Does that make sense? That's the old compound interest thing. You know, that putting money in a bank, not just earning 1.5% in a savings, but compound interest, put away, save not for a year. If you save a dollar this year, you know what you're going to have a year from now? $1.03, maybe. But if you save a little bit and you don't touch it for 40 years, and it builds like it should, you have a nice little pile of money, or at least that's what I'm hoping. Small, seemingly insignificant choices and habits done consistently over a long period of time will yield radical difference. If we tuned our ears to other people, and if we asked questions, if we asked history, heart, habits, hurts, questions. If we followed up with people, called them by name, listened more than we spoke. If we sought to understand before being understood, we would build relationship. And those people may know you a little bit better. Here's the thing. Every now and then I think that, well, everybody's looking for Jesus, aren't they? No, not really. Not everybody wants a church. Not everybody wants Jesus. Now, I think that they do, but that's just me. I think that they're looking for Jesus. They're looking for Jesus in lots of other ways, but not everybody today would say, you're looking for Jesus, and I go, hey, I know Jesus. Let me introduce you to Jesus. But almost every single person that I've ever come across is looking for friendship and relationship. And while they're not looking for a church, hey, come to church with me, or a savior, hey, let me tell you about Jesus, you can start that relationship through friendship. And the cheat code, I'm telling you, it's my belief that it's being a better listener. Beginning with prayer, like I preached on last week, and listening might sound overwhelmingly simple. But I'd like to challenge you, could we do it? These are things you can do. And so far, it's not cost you a penny, right? We're not asking brand new things. I hope you as a follower of Jesus are already praying. I hope you as a follower of Jesus aren't so overwhelmingly repugnant that you already have a few people that have a favorable opinion of you, and they might have an even more favorable opinion if you were a better listener. That's my hope for me. Now, if you're an introvert, you love these first two things. If you're an extrovert, you're itching. Stick around. Next Sunday, you get to be an extrovert, okay? These next few weeks, these are the 3, 4, and 5, these are more extrovert habits. These first two are for us introverts. Want to pray. Want to listen. We'll give you something a little bit more practical to do next week and the next week and the next week. But I'm telling you, to build friendships with people starts with, tell me your story. Not just, here's what I have to say about Jesus. Not just, here's my church is the best church, and you need to come to my church. Now, we want you to invite people to come. But to start by being a good friend. And if you'll look for those red cars, you'll see them. And if you pray, God, send me red cars. Give me eyes to see red cars. And if you pray for people specifically by name, give me an opportunity to bless them. And when God gives you those ping moments, you decide now that you're going to be a bit more of a listener than a talker. Those friendships begin to flourish. Jesus asked over 300 questions. We tend to think of Jesus as a teacher, that he just spieled. But he engaged with people. And I think if we did this small, seemingly insignificant things consistently over time, that we would be a more attractive people. One of our first dates, we went and walked the mall at Olivet. We walked the mall a couple of years ago when we went back, and it is a ghost town. The doors open for mall walkers now. But we went, and we saw a little food court where the coffee place used to be. Remember Matt and Kim? Barney's? Okay. Little food court. And Dana and we sat there, one of our very first dates, and I tried to get her to talk because she was so quiet. Tried to get her to talk. And so what did I do? I talked. Blabbity, blabbity, blah, 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 blah. I was more of a talker then than I am now. But I talked and talked and talked and talked and talked. And she had no choice. I was her ride. She listened. But she hung in there for one more date where she was hoping I would shut up long enough to let her to talk. I think we can do this, and I think if we do this, God will bless this, and God will bless us. We can be a blessing to others, and the kingdom expands. Several times this week when people sent me, light your candle, light your candle, light your candle, I said, one conversation, one interaction, one moment, one conversation at a time, the kingdom comes. Every moment matters, even when we're not talking. Would you stand up with me? If we listen, we might hear somebody's practical need. This week, somebody messaged me and said, my mower's broken. Do you know of anybody who can help? And I did. I've got somebody who said, I like to cut grass. Show me tall grass. I will make it small grass. And so I was able to hook that up. That's another one of our practices we're going to talk about here soon. But if you'll listen, you'll hear about somebody's practical needs, something we can easily meet. You might hear somebody's emotional need. You might just need to be a friend to them, listening to them. You might hear of somebody's spiritual need. You can come along beside them and say, I'm praying for you. I'm going to the Father for you. I want to be here to support you. Pray for opportunities to show specific people that God loves you because you love them. God shows up with your skin on them. And sometimes God shows up and shows that love merely by your presence and by listening. One more quote. I love this. Mike Glenn says, more people are loved into the kingdom than are ever argued into it. Would you pray with me? God, you gave yourself to this world. Jesus didn't just send a message. Jesus came. You were present. And here in Luke 18, in the midst of the noise, somehow your ears were attuned to the cry of blind Bartimaeus over in the corner, low, bedraggled, poor, destitute, blind Bartimaeus over at the side, covered in dust, ignored by everyone, and told to shush when he yelled out your name. You heard him because you listen for the cry of your children. Help us to do the same. All of us know somebody who might feel far from God. All of us know somebody who probably could use a friend or another friend or a better friend. Send us to them. Give us opportunities this week to bless other people for your glory. In your great name we pray. Amen.